Dr. Nomanul Haq, who is currently a senior faculty member at the Lahore University of Management Sciences. His areas of work includes Islamic history, Islamic intellectual history, and Islamic philosophy, which is more or less the same thing, which is covered in the term Islamic intellectual history. He has previously taught at the University of Pennsylvania and continues to hold a formal faculty position over there. He has been trained at the University College London and Harvard in the fields of medieval Islamic intellectual history, and has also received a postdoctoral fellowship at Harvard before taking up an appointment at Brown University. He has recently shared the Waldo Leland Prize of the American Historical Association for his writings in the New Cambridge History of Islam. He has published widely, and his work has been carried by some of the world's most prestigious research journals. It is my pleasure to welcome him on for this conversation. I'm going to ask Dr. Noman to open with a few comments, and then I'm going to ask a few questions, and then we can open the conversation to the audience. Dr. Noman.
Well, thank you very much. I see some very distinguished people in the audience. Umar Mehman Sahab came, and I'm very, very grateful to him. Intezar Hussain Sahab is here. And if I fail to recognize those whom I ought to, please do forgive me. Bilal and I had been wondering what the format of this event would be, and we just couldn't decide, so it'll take its own life and let it move the way it moves. I think what I'll do is this. I shall start with a few observations. Then I will read a few very, very brief anecdotal expressions, and then I'll do some analysis, after which I am at the mercy of Bilal and the audience. So let me begin with the observations that I want to make. Let me say that over the past so many years, I have talked about these observations in various forums, and I've written about them. But perhaps this is the first time when I have such a distinguished gathering listening to me, so I'm hoping that the benefits would be greater than I have ever expected. One thing has to do with the external history of our times, I often say that since the 19th century, this was the time of what we call the Enlightenment, after the scientific revolution, the Newtonian revolution, changes in the world economy and industrial revolution and so on and so forth, the world has grown in such a way that no longer any act, any tradition, any economy can flourish in isolation. There can be no isolation, meaning that the global context has become very important. Otherwise, things wither on the periphery. There can be no isolationist existence, as was the case in the medieval world. Worlds were apart, and pockets of communities could survive apart from one another. That is no longer the case. And I believe this is external history. This is not something internal to literature. My interest lies in the inner world of literature, not in external history. But somehow, the manifestation of literature has to be in the outer world. So one cannot be totally oblivious to what is going on outside the realm of literary expression. This has had an ironic consequence, and the consequence is that on the one hand, it has become very, very important for local histories to be studied. You have heard this phrase, all history is local. And this is an ironic statement because all history is local in the sense that somehow to connect local conditions to the wider global perspective, you need to go deep into local traditions. What I mean is that there is now a vertical dimension, vertically downward dimension, when we go more and more into local conditions and local literature and local value systems on the one hand, and then on the other hand, the horizontal dimension in which all of this has to be connected somehow to what is going on in the world. So this is one point that I wanted to make, and since in the spirit of postmodernism, I really don't want to throw any jargon upon you. I hate jargon, and there is this movement called postmodernism, and there is this attitude called postmodernity. Even though this whole attitude, this whole movement has serious problems and questions, I think that it has taught us some very important things in terms of our appreciation of literature and understanding of human expressions. And one of the things that has to be understood is that we have in contemporary times, I don't want to use the word modern, because the word modern is to me loaded, heavily loaded. Let us put it chronologically. If we put it chronologically, then I would say that that in the contemporary world we have resisted grand narratives, resistance of grand narratives would mean that we go deeper into local conditions. Why did Arabs cultivate Greek science? One answer is that Greek sciences were great, and they had to do it. Why was there a scientific revolution? Because Europe had to rise, and human history is just a prelude to the rise of Europe. These are questions. These are answers which are grounded, which are couched in terms of grand narratives, and we have resisted them because they close up historical questions. As for the first one, just as a matter of quick remark, the cultivation of the Greek sciences on the part of the Arabs is something that was historically highly improbable. And the beauty of it lies in the fact that it was so improbable and yet it happened, and therefore one has to ask the question, the local question, as to why did it happen? What were the conditions? So rather than closing up historical questions, you open up historical questions and open new vistas. And this is something that postmodernism has given us. It may not have given us answers. It may not have given us good outcomes. We may not agree with the outcomes, but it has in the process opened up new vistas of analysis, and they are very important vistas through which we look and observe important things. So this is the first observation I want to make. Second observation, and they might look to you as unconnected, but I very much hope that I'm able to bring some connections in them. They look isolated and haphazard, I hope that some connections, you know, important fundamental connections, become clear as my discourse moves on. So the second thing is this thing which I call the severance of tradition, the rupture. The word rupture is very good, rupture. Now, in the history of the colonial world, there is a rupture, meaning that colonial societies were cut off from their own tradition. Lord Macaulay, for example, had an educational policy which connected the locals to Western history and disconnected from their own legacies. So there has been a rupture. And it is this rupture which makes us see sources of all important ideas into a particular tradition, not recognizing that those ideas, attitudes may have been part of their own legacy. This is the deep irony. This is the deep irony of things. You remember that I talked about post-modernity and post-modernism, post-modernity is an attitude. And that attitude I see way earlier in the Arabic tradition, in the Persian tradition. I mean, I see that attitude very much in Bedil, for example. Shaira khub monina darad, good verse has no meaning, monina darad. Or I see it, you know, I have Mamun Sahab sitting before me, a scholar of Arabic, Qudama ibn Ja'far in Naqd al-Shair, saying, Ahsanu al-Shair akthabuhu, the best shair, the best verse lies most, is the worst liar. The best verse is the... but that in an utterly different sense.
Please repeat that.
The Arabic expression is ahsanu al-sha'ri. If I use the vowels ahsanu al-sha'ri, akzabahu, akzab, the most liar, the worst liar. The best one is the worst liar. This is and I think that if I were to read this expression to Terry Eagleton, he'd be very happy. Terry Eagleton will be overjoyed to hear this thing from somebody writing, I think, in the 12th century. So this rupture is something you have to keep in mind. That when you see often when one talks about what has been yielded to us by a postmodernist analysis, often one is accused of imposing, you know, Western analytical tools onto Urdu and Persian poetry, forgetting that because of this rupture, because of this separation from tradition, one does not recognize that some of these attitudes exist in the Persian tradition and in the Arabic tradition, you know, way before that. So that is the second thing I want to say. And the third observation of mine, which may seem to you unconnected with the first two, it has to do with what I call the autonomy of a piece of literature. I think that to reduce a work of art to its external conditions, to the biography of the writer, to the intention of the writer, to certain political and ideological frameworks, is a mistake. I have often appropriated a passage from Charles Dickens. I have plucked it out of its environment and I use it for my own purposes, where there is a conversation between the lord of the mansion and a worker of the mansion, a maid, a conversation between the maid and the lord, and the lord says, this floor looks much too empty. Let us have a carpet here. Let's have a carpet. And the maid says, what kind of a carpet, my lord? And the lord says, well, we should have a carpet with birds and flowers and trees on them. To which the maid responds, but my lord, people will be walking over the birds. They'll be trampling those flowers. And the lord says, they're not those kinds of birds and flowers, you idiot. And this is the point of the autonomy of the work of art, meaning that the flowers and the birds in a work of art, in the rug, make sense only in the context of the rug. They cannot be verified in nature. There is a resemblance indeed. One has to draw one's raw material from nature, from the world around. But what one does with it gives it a new life. It is creation. Thereby it is creation. Manzar ek balandi par aur hum bana sakte. That is the idea. Arsh se pare hota kaash ke makaan apna. We want to build a house beyond the horizons. above the horizon. It is that creation of a new world with its own logic, which will make sense on its own terms. A narrative is its own reference, not in terms of its verification. Recently, an art historian whose name is Valery Gonzalez, a friend of mine, Valery Gonzalez, was a student of the one I consider the greatest historian of Islamic art in the contemporary world, Oleg Grabar. Oleg Grabar was a professor at Harvard. I took a few courses with him, and then he went to the Institute for Advanced Study at Princeton. Valery Gonzalez was his student, and she has a book which has a rather bland title. I don't like the title of the book. It's called Beauty and Islam. She asked me to write an introduction to it, which I did. This was a lecture she gave in French at the Institute of Ismaili Studies in London. And one of the greatest things about her is that she uses phenomenology, Husserl and so on, in order to interpret certain verses of the Quran. And I think that this is how, perhaps, if I may be so bold as to say, that this is how maybe Tafasir should be written now. She talks about the story of the Solomon, of the palace of Solomon, King Solomon, and the Queen of Sheba, Bilqis, and the famous story known to you, Saqisimi, comes from there, that the queen steps on a floor and she considers it to be water, and she lifts her skirt, and then she is told that it is not water. It looks like water, but it is not water. And from there she develops this whole discourse between resemblance and representation. It resembles, but it is not a representation. This is the conceptual gain there between resemblance and representation, and that I find fascinating. Famous artist, Faizi Rahmian, Atiya Faizi, the woman, a famous lady, the famous grand lady, her husband, he wrote something for a magazine. I don't know if Kishwar Nahid is here. Mahe no, Kishwar Nahid used to edit it for a long, long time, and he quotes an anecdote from the Mughal Emperor Jahangir, in which a young artist comes to the emperor and asks Jahangir to commission him to make a painting. He says, "Your Majesty gave me leave to do some painting for you." And Jahangir says, "What is your specialty? What will you do? Tell me." And the young artist says, "Your Majesty, I shall paint this garden the way it is." Upon which Jahangir says, "If I want to see this garden as it is, I'll go and look at it. Away with you." What is the point being made here? The point being made is that it is not a representation. It is creation. It is creation of a new logic. It's a creation of a new framework. It's a creation of a poetic world, and that poetic world has its own logic. And I mean, this can also be said about works of fiction. Fiction would mean that you distort reality, you distort your characters in order to fit the narrative. It is this distortion which makes it fiction. Otherwise, it is report. It is a report that you go and make in a police station, or a report that a newspaper journalist sends and files in the morning. It is something else. It is that something else which has to be understood. The autonomy. And in this attitude, as I have said, it should be understood that it has been this fateful rupture. We read these things in Terry Eagleton and in Foucault and in Derrida. We don't read it in Ghalib, and we don't read it in Bedil. We don't read it in Hafez. Hafez has said, "Gulbarg ra ze sumbule mushki naqab kun." Gulbarg ra ze sumbule mushki naqab kun. Yani ke rukh be posh aur jahane kharab kun. cover your face, so that, you know, you just you know, devastate us. Then we'll be wondering what you are, what is behind it. Uska aanchal hai ke rukhsar ke pehran hai, kuch to hai jisse hui jaati hai chilman rangi. Jane us zulf ki mahum ghani chhaon mein timtimata hai wo aaveza abhi tak ke nahi. This is poetry. This is poetry. What is behind it? What is behind it? Us yani ke rukh bepoch, chehra chupa lo, kharab karo jahan ko, just cover your face and devastate us. This is what it is. When Meer Sahab says, kiya tha sher ko parda sukhan ka. My poetry is a veil over what I want to say. Wahi aakhir ko thehra fun hamara. And then, you know, Ghalib saying, apni hasti hi se ho jo kuch ho. Aage hi gar nahi ghaflat hi se. Aage hi nahi ghaf, apni hasti hi se ho jo kuch. This is what I mean. This is creation. This is creation of a new world. Otherwise, it is not creative art. So I'm talking about the autonomy of a work of art. Now, if I may just express one pain of mine, one frustration of mine before all of you, and it is that we have just seen the end of the centennial year of Faiz Ahmed Faiz. Hardly at all in this year people have spoken about the poetics of Faiz. It is his ideology, it is the external world, it is his heart for the poor, his mazdoor ka gosht, taaj uchhale jayenge aur takht giraye jayenge. Nobody has written about his poetics. Nobody has written about hardly anybody. I am the sole voice here and there. And I'm unpopular because I talk about poetics. I don't talk about socialism. I don't talk about progressive writers. I'm not interested. I'm interested in Faiz Sahab's imagery. I'm interested in his metaphorical network, the network of metaphors. You know, his the Sabke Hindi style. So the Sabke Hindi in which reality is turned into a metaphor, and then that metaphor is considered reality, and further metaphors are generated. This honeycomb of metaphors that you have. Aankhon se lagaya hai kabhi daste sabha ko. Aankhon se lagaya hai kabhi daste sabha ko. Dali hai kabhi gardane mehtab mein baahein. Dali hai kabhi gardane mehtab mein baahein. What is this? Aankhon se lagaya kabhi. What is this? Daste sabha, does the wind have a hand? And you can touch that hand on your eyes, right? Can you put your arms around the moon, right? Chandni ka ulajna, sham ke pechukham sitaron se zina utar rahi harat, yun sabha paas se guzarti hai, jaise kehti kisi ne pyar ki baat, sabz goshon mein neel gusaye lehlahate hain jis tarah dil mein mauje darde firaq yaar. Shanae baam par damakta hai meherban chandni ka daste jameel, khak mein ghul gayi hai aab nujum, noor mein ghul gaya hai arsh kaneel. This is it. Now nobody is talking about that. Nobody is talking about this world. And remember that in this world when it is manotu se paida, manotu se pak, arises out of history but going beyond history. Nobody, I'm not so naive and absurd as to say that a poet has nothing to do with his environment. He has nothing to do with his society. He has nothing to do, he or she has nothing to do. I have some very important poets, female poets. I must use my pronouns carefully, his or her. His or her, a poet, is not totally unconnected with his or her environment, his or her experiences. But the point is to transcend that. It is that transcendence which makes it poetry, otherwise it is nothing but report. It is for this reason that Ghalib is so great. It is for this reason that Bedil is so great. It is for those who are just reporters, who write topical poetry, really are not considered by history, by our time. Despite politics, they will not be remembered. I really don't think, I consider Noon Mim Rashid and Faiz Sahab higher than Habib Jalib. No matter how much we love Habib Jalib, but it is his topicality which locks it into a particular history. space and time, whereas this is not the case with Ghalib, and this is not the case with Faiz Sahab and Noon Rashid and great poets like Iqbal. So that is the other point I want to make, and it is for this reason that when experiences are transcended, when you treat the experience and create a world, a poetic world with its own rhythms, right, with its own passions, with its own rules, with its own narrative structure, with its own meanings, once you do that, then there is little difference between Shakespeare and Iqbal. They can meet, they can sit together, they really can sit together, and then there is no problem there, because you have to sort of one has to take it above the earth from which it grows. So these are the observations I want to make, and I promised to read a very brief anecdotes, anecdotal, I call them anecdotal expressions, and then I have a few suggestions, and after that I am at your mercy. Then you do whatever you wahi suluk kare jo badshahon ke saath karte hain. Mere saath wahi suluk kijiyega jo badshahon ke saath karte hain. Treat me as kings treat kings. This is the end of an article of Shamsur Rahman Faruqi, whom I consider very important, from the point of view of critical discourses. This is the end of his article that he wrote on Noon Mim Rashid, and let me read this to you, then read something else, and then I will come to Ghalib. This is about Rashid. I have this. Yeah, ab agar aap poochhein. I hope I know that I don't need to translate these things, but if I do, let me know. اب اگر آپ یہ پوچھیں کہ اتنی تفصیلی گفتگو کے باوجود میں نے سیاسی مسائل کی طرف راشد کے رویے مذہب سیاست اور عشق الخصوص مذہب اور سیاست سے ان کی دلچسپی انسان دوستی استعمار اور جبر کے خلاف ان کے احتجاج ان کے مفکرانہ خطیبانہ پیمبرانہ لہجے کی جلالت وغیرہ کو کیوں نظر انداز کر دیا تو میں یہی کہوں گا کہ میری نظر میں راشد کا سب سے بڑا کارنامہ یہی ہے کہ انہوں نے اپنی شاعری کو اپنے انتہائی بیدار سماجی اور سیاسی شعور کے ہاتھوں اونے پونے نہ بیچ کر شاعرانہ آہنگ کے پاس رہن رکھ دیا. یہ ایسی ٹیڑھی منزل ہے جسے ہر شاعر خوش اسلوبی سے سر نہیں کر سکتا. باقی رہا سماجی اور سیاسی شعور, میں دوبارہ پڑھتا ہوں, باقی رہا سیاسی اور سماجی شعور تو وہ ہر دکان پر ملتا ہے. This is Faruqi sir. Writing about Mir Taqi Mir, he says, آج کل لوگ اکثر پوچھ دیتے ہیں, صاحب اس شاعر نے ہمارے لیے کیا پیغام دیا ہے. And this پیغام thing, nobody has been a worst victim of the earth than one I consider, one of the greatest poets of the world, that is Iqbal. Iqbal has been the worst victim of this paigham business. Iqbal ka paigham kya hai? One does not know kya paigham hai. Anyway, aaj kal log aksar pooch dete hain, sahib is shayar ne hamare liye kya paigham diya hai. Meer ke zamane mein meer se ye sawal poocha jata to wo tevri par bal laate aur chup rehte, lekin agar wo aaj hote اور اس موقع پر کوئی جیالہ ان سے پوچھ ہی بیٹھتا تو ان کا جواب شاید یہ ہوتا کہ ہم نے مجلس آفاق بھی گرم کی, جل بھی بجھے, اور اسی جل بجھنے میں اپنی شام کو سحر کر دیا. ہو سکے تو تم بھی یہی کر دیکھو. بیوٹیفل. دس از ریلی بیوٹیفل. اچھا ناؤ کمنگ ٹو one anecdote, a historical, please pay full attention to it, and if I do not get your agreement, I very much hope that I'll get your serious attention to these matters. Maulana Fazliha Khairabadi, whom nearly all of you know, very close friend of Ghalib, Maulana Fazliha Khairabadi ke shagirdon mein se ek shakhs ne Nasir Ali Sirhindi ke kisi sher ke maani Mirza Ghalib se puche. Unhone kuch maani bayan kiye. Usne wahan se aakar Maulana se kaha, aap Mirza sahab ki sukhan fahmi aur sukhan sanji ki is qadar tareef kiya karte hain, aaj unhone ek sher ke maani bilkul galat bayan kiye. Aur phir wo sher padha aur jo kuch Mirza ne uske maani kahe the bayan kiye. Maulana ne ye farmaya, phir in maano mein kya burai hai? Usne kaha, burai to kuch ho ya na ho, magar Nasir Ali ka ye maqsood nahi hai. Maulana ne kaha, agar Nasir Ali ne wo maani murad nahi liye jo Mirza ne samjhe, to usne sakht galati ki. Aur ye sher Nasir Ali ka tha, ye sher Nasir Ali ka tha. Unhone ye samjha to galat kiya. Gaur kijiye is baat par kehna kya hai yahan. Kehne the point is simply that like a child who has the seed of the parents but has his or her own will. The poetry has its own will, its own autonomy. I have often transferred this to the visual arts, and when I talk about the luxuriance of color in Mughal miniatures, I say that the luxuriance of color in Mughal miniatures is simply an assertion of the graphic autonomy of the work of art, so that one is so absorbed in it that one doesn't even think of the world of nature outside. One is lost in it. Masti se har nigah tere rukh par bikhar gayi. Nazare ne bhi kaam kiya wa naqab ka. This is what I am saying. Nazare ne bhi kaam kiya wa naqab ka. Main namurad dil ki tasalli ko kya karun? Main namurad dil ki tasalli ko kya karun? Mana ke tere rukh se nigah kamyab hai. Mana ke tere rukh se nigah kamyab. This is Ghalib. Masti se har, nazare ne bhi kaam kiya wa naqab ka. This is that thing. The autonomy. Do not get out. Do not talk about any references of this painting with the world. This painting is its own creative world, autonomous world, and it should be viewed on its own terms. The signifier itself has a value. Don't worry about the signified. The signifier itself has, the appellation has its own value. This is what is being said here. Now, finally, I will read a few lines from Shakespeare, As You Like It. It is in the third act. Audrey, I do not know what poetical is. I do not know what poetical is. Is it honest in deed and word? Is it honest in deed and word? Is it a true thing? Again, is it a true thing? Touchstone, no, truly. For the truest poetry is the most feigning. The truest poetry is the most feigning. This is Shakespeare. Now, finally, before I end, I said that I will talk about a few suggestions of mine, and it is that for too long, people have reduced analysis of poetry, criticism, to external conditions. This has been the fashion of the progressive movement to talk about ideology, and my own view is that insofar as a piece of poetry, insofar as a piece of fiction is a creative piece of work, it has its own logic and cannot possibly be reduced to certain fixed historical conditions. Okay? The idea that the meaning of an utterance, the meaning of an utterance or a text is what the speaker had in mind, has to be destroyed. We don't know. When I write something, I look for my own self in that. The writer is perhaps not a good person to talk about his or her own work. मोतबर नहीं है उसका कहना ठीक है सो इट हैज बीन टू लॉन्ग दैट वी हैव डन दिस एंड अनफॉर्चुनेटली यू नो वी हैड अ सेंटेनियल ईयर फॉर फैज साहब एंड आई डिड नॉट सी अ थिंग which really talks about his poetics in a sustained discourse. There may have been exceptions, and there may have been one or two articles here and there, but a sustained discourse on his poetics is still very much lacking. And the other prong, the other side dimension of what I'm saying is that Urdu literature, and I'm supposed to be talking about the shifting paradigms of Urdu literature. Urdu literature, appreciation and understanding of the Urdu literature will only live at best at the periphery and will hardly survive till it has some relevance to contemporary world literature. It will not survive. So one has to reposition it, rehabilitate it. And it is not really an act of dislocating it. No, it is an act of relocating it, because as I have said, that there has been historical, and looking at world history, I'm looking at world civilization, there has been a rupture. And that rupture has severed links with a continuity of the tradition. And if you recover it, you will see that these attitudes are really, you know, important even within the context of Urdu, Persian, and Arabic poetry. I think perhaps I should stop here, please provoke me to say more. Even though there was a confusion about whether I should be speaking in English or in Urdu. Initially, Asif Farooqi told me to do it in English, and then I found out that it is not in English and so on. So we decided to do it in English, but it does not mean at all that you cannot comment in Urdu. And it does not mean, I hope, that I won't be able to answer you in Urdu. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, I think that we are a bit short on time, so I'm just going to cut my questions out and I'm just going to go directly to the audience. Umar Meeman Saab has a question here. Can we have Lionel? Can we have a mic, please? Meeman Saab, I think everyone should benefit from your question.
Yes, anyone should benefit.
This thing that I have a very dense mind and things don't sink in.
Sir, you are not audible.
Can you turn on the mic, please? I think that the mic's not turned on.
Speak into the mic.
No, I think.
Is it on?
Open.
It is on.
You have to seekhna padega. Oh boy. Well, you see, my personal problem is, although I see the validity of Gahe Gahe Baz Khan in Qissa Parinara, first of all, I have difficulty in relating what seem to be three points that you, your observation. One seems to deal with globalization. Bhai, main kya karu phir main ab?
Mehmet Saab, yahan.
You have made a joke of.
No, not at all. Please.
Okay, so, all right.
Yeah, theek hai?
Well, the thing is that the three points, and then you talk about autonomy of literature. Now, this is an extremely general sort of thing, and I can see lots of shakhsane branching out of these ideas, and I'm not quite able to interconnect them to arrive at some very tangible. Well, I don't know whether you would like to call it presentation or something that is gelled properly, and then we can take matters from that point on. These are exceedingly general observations, and when you were quoting Dickens, I was thinking, well, why not quote from a contemporary Persian critic. I don't remember the name, but I can always say, who has written a whole book in which he is analyzing Shahnameh, and he says that the notion of epic as it is developed in the West simply will not apply. You have to generate your own critical apparatus by delving into the thing itself, which actually happens with all literature criticism and what you call the architectonics, whereby you put together things. They are always derivative and later than the piece of writing. It's, you drive them from there. Now the point is this, that this has been said millions of times, and so what's the point of saying them all again? What I would have thought, just one little piece, and analyzing it, to somehow there contextualize your main arguments by showing us what precisely is at stake. Otherwise, it's a very nice presentation with a little bit of poetry, with a little bit of fast thrown in for good measure, and Noon Mim Rashid and what have you. But then we all go away without any overarching notion of what it is that we have gathered to discuss. So my problem was basically this. Now, autonomy of literature also raises certain issues, whether you are dealing with poetry or you are dealing with prose. When you are dealing with poetry, and then you also want that we cannot live in isolation with the rest of the world, the problem is this, that your Ghazal tradition is an entirely different poetics. And you can go farther back. I mean, in your argument, you start with Plato, for instance, and Plato was talking about reality and poetry, two times removed from reality. So it's a useless form. But he thought that poetry's purpose was to, you know, represent reality. That was not ever the case with the Muslim Islamic cultural tradition. Starting with the Quran, where you have a famous line that the poets are a people who wander into every valley and they say things which they do not do. Now, from a moral point of view, when you are looking from the early Islamic point of view, you see that society needs more than anything else some way to build it. So obviously poetry is of no use there. But negatively, it is also giving you the best tradition, best definition of what poetry is all about. Maximum freedom to wander into imagination. So the Arabs or the Persians or later our writers never took Ghazal to be representing any kind of reality. Its analog is in the mind. It's never out there. Then there is a problem of language. So I can go on, but this is not my purpose. Really, what I would have loved to see is just one short story, and let us see how it doesn't work, or how does it work. Or maybe a ghazal. And then see from there whether its autonomy has been compromised, whether it relates to the world.
Vimal Sahib, thank you. I think that point is very well taken. I mean, you may keep sitting
actually. No, I don't have to sit here. I'll take my place.
Okay, no, yeah. I mean, your place is actually here. No. I should be the one who's sitting there. No, thank you. I think that what Mehman Sahib, the point is actually very important. And I think it connects back to what, in fact, Dr. Noman was saying earlier on, is precisely that space for poetry to be treated as imagination is shrinking. And I think that that's what Dr. Noman al-Haq was contesting. Let's just go back to the audience. Is there somebody who can take around the mics, please? Lionel, are you here still? You're not here. Gentlemen, huh? Sure. Okay, can I request you all to sort of make it into questions rather than... Mehman Sahib obviously is an exception because Mehman Sahib is...
Dr. Noman, you have reservations with the word postmodernism, and you're rightly so. Can you please explain it to us, exactly what is it or what should it be? Thank you.
Well, this is a question I really cannot possibly answer.
Some of the things I have said, for example, the fact that if you look at a novel and consider it to be the intention of the author, if you relate it to particular specific historical circumstances in which the novel is written, if you consider the eye of the novel as the author of the novel, if you fix the meaning of the words with what they signify, all of these things are challenged in postmodernist thinking. There are, you know, notions which are constructed, and then we don't deal with these notions. So this is part of the attitude that you know, the what I call the autonomy is also part of that, that you have to consider a narrative on its own terms. A narrative is its own reference. It has no reference to, you know, the outside world. So it is this kind of thing. But to answer the question fully will not be possible. But sort of what I have done myself, if you like, what I have done myself is itself in the same vein of how postmodernists speak.
Thank you. Okay, can we have a question from the back, please?
Presentation. And I was just reflecting when you were saying that Fairs ko kahin celebrate nahi kiya gaya. When I enter here, I saw Charles Dickens quotations everywhere. Why not Fairs? Why not Ghalib? And why not other poets and contemporary poets and writers' quotations there? So it enlightened our hearts. And you were talking about how to, you know, create a position of art literature in contemporary world. I think our Persian literature, Urdu literature, Arabic literature to be alive. Because our children can read Urdu books in English and English authors, Laila Vadimna, and other Persian thoughts and similes, they're unaware. Our curriculum is empty from those poets and those. So
can we
can think.
Please?
My question is rather extension of what contemporary alive, how to alive contemporary of literature, that we need to go at grassroots level, curriculum level, and to be taught at grassroots level, school
Thank
level,
you.
And thinking imagination to be alive of our children.
Thank
Without
you.
That, you
Thank
know,
you.
It's not possible.
Somebody else has a question, please.
Dr. Saab, thank you for your presentation. I just want to ask about what you exactly mean by poetics of Fairs, or the word poetics. Is, you know, are you talking, referring to the sacred dimension of the poetry as opposed to the historical, secular interpretation of poetry?
With that, I think that, along with the one that the gentleman raised earlier about why is the session in English if it's about religion.
Was there a question about why it is in English?
Yes, I think almost it was that question. And I was going to anticipate that. There is always that question. It has to be there.
Gotcha.
And, you know.
Okay. Okay. Yes. Anyway, the...
Some recommendation for the children?
Yeah, for the children. Yes. Yes. Well, a very quick answer to your question concerning the children is that we have to make Urdu relevant to their lives, to the times, and the way Urdu is presented is really very archaic. People still are operating in sort of pre-modern, knowledge background, and when they speak to bright students, they consider them, you know, totally unaware. So they are unimpressed. I mean, the interest of young people, let me tell you before, you know, we're overjoyed. We must understand that the interest of young people in Urdu is largely of a romantic kind. They just love good poetry, the rhythmic structure, you know, Bollywood. They send messages on their, you know, mobile phones. But the engagement is romantic. It has to be more than that. It has to be substantive. It has to be part of the thrust of their thought. It should have some relevance to economic theories and to scientific theories and so on and so forth. So relevance of it is very important. So art critics have to become themselves up to date and not talk about Galenic medicine in talking about Ghalib. Jigar ki Urdu mein istilah is wajah se hai ki jigar mein har lahza khoon banta rehta hai, which is absurd. This is not true. If a medical student hears it, he will totally reject it. Ke baba ji ne sher to achhe padhe, magar kakh pata nahi. आता बाता कुछ नहीं बेचारे को. दिस इज द एटीट्यूड दे डेवलप. दे सीन द पब्लिकेशन ऑफ बुक्स इज वेरी रिलेवेंट रिलेवेंट हियर इन द केस ऑफ ऑफ of the Oxford University Press, that the publication of books that are free of error, that you can read, that the kids can hold in hand and enjoy. The, you know, when I was growing up, you know, my house had, I don't know how many editions of Divan-e-Ghalib, but they were all so badly printed that I could not read them. When I went to England and I got hold of Iqbal, Iqbal was very careful in the way his books were published, and I could read Iqbal, and once I read it, that day and this day. So it is very important. These are some of the part of my quick answers. Now, as for the poetics, this is an important question. I think that one must not be talking about secular religious. You know, it as I said, it is a self-perpetuating world where, you know, imageries, rhythmic structures, its relationship with the poetic tradition, in what way is Ghalib related, for example, to Wali and Baidil and so on, that the play of metaphors, okay, the meaning creation, what we call mazmu afrini, what we call mani afrini, creation of meanings and creations of subject, this is what I'm talking about. These are the things that have not been talked about in the case of Faz. He was reduced to his ideology, and my position is, and you may disagree, you have every right to disagree with me, is that where Faz Sahab has become ideological, his poetry has weakened. Where he is a poet, he is great. The moment he talks about mazdoor ka gosht and taj uchale jayenge, it becomes populist. When he talks about uska aanchal hai ke rukhsar ke pairahan hai, he is a great poet. The sensitivity in him, the softness in him, the silk in him is unparalleled in the history of Urdu literature. So this is my position.
Thank you. I think with that we will close the session. Thank you all for being here. We greatly appreciate it. Thank you. And Dr. Nomar.